Hey everybody, this is Dianne. Hello and welcome to Biters.
And this is Marnell. And Alpha Beta Gamma was actually my sorority in college.
And they were all just as creepy as the people in The Walking Dead.
Well, Hell Week was wearing other people's faces. So.
Oh my god. All right, so we are talking about We Are the End of the World. Not We Are the World, not to be confused with that.
Or It's the End of the World.
As we know it.
Season 10, Episode 2, We Are the End of the World.
Which was essentially our beta backstory.
Yeah. A little more on Alpha, but mostly Beta.
Yeah. So tell me your rating.
I didn't rate it as highly as last week because I didn't like it as much as last week. Because, I mean, how do you compare to last week? But I gave it a 4.3 stuffed bunnies. What is it with this show and bunnies?
Oh, that's right. Because that's right? What Summer is carrying when you first see her, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
Or is it bunny slippers?
Bunny slippers.
Bunny slippers.
Yeah. Bunny slippers.
Yes. Yep. Good catch.
Little girls and bunnies in the show.
Well, I didn't rate it as high as last week, but I rated it pretty high and pretty much the same. I liked it. I didn't like it quite as much as I liked last week. So I gave it a 4.513 murderous sisters out of 5.
You texted me, sisters over alpha.
Yes, absolutely. So the numbers were a bummer. The headline on TVbythenumbers.com was The Walking Dead slips. So they didn't have the numbers for the week out. They only had the numbers for the day. So on Sunday, it was number 2. It was beat out by Sports Ball. 3.47 million views. So it actually was below 4 million views this time, which is a series low. And it was 1.3 in the 18 to 49 group.
That's crazy because, you know, we talk about Preacher being terrible ratings at like 1.14, but that's still just about half of what Walking Dead is now doing.
Right.
It's got to be people watching it online.
Well, I've got a little bit about that in Whisperer's Corner.
Sweet.
Yeah. So the title, We Are the End of the World. So that was the interaction between Beta and Alpha at the end.
Right.
Which I thought it was so interesting that he was like, I am the end of the world. And she corrects him and she's like, no, we are the end of the world.
Oh, man. On Talking Dead, I know that some people don't like her, but I could not agree more with Yvette Nicole Brown. Like, Alpha is a cult leader. She used every tactic that cult leaders used to,
actually wrote down what she said about the singing.
Yes,
because
mirroring.
She was right. I mean, Alpha was totally mirroring Beta to suck him in.
Yeah. And she's a pro, man. She clocked him from 100 yards.
Yeah, pretty scary.
Yep.
So it did make me think about Rick's We Are the Walking Dead line, mm-hmm. because it kind of was a nod to that. At least I felt like it was a nod to that.
Huh, I didn't call back to that.
I did that on the second watch. I didn't really pick that up on the first watch.
I have It's the End of the World as We Know It stuck in my head now.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no. Like, they play it on one of our radio stations that plays, like, quote-unquote oldies, if that's considered an oldie.
It's probably, like, the only REM song that they play.
Probably, yeah. They
Which
do
is
the
a great
Beatles
song, but it's probably the only REM song that they know.
And they play it, like, at least every other day, so I hear it on my drive-in or out if I'm not listening to a podcast. So, yeah, no, it's stuck in my head permanently because of that, but this show, I'm having a hard time not saying it's the end of the world.
Well, let me help you out just a little bit here. So it really freaked me out. I couldn't figure out what song they were humming.
Walking after midnight, out in the moonlight, just like we used to do.
So I didn't pick up until I watched talking what they were humming.
It sounded familiar, but I could not have named that tune in four notes, you know?
If it had been a little more on key, I might have figured it out. And when I watched the repeat, Alpha was a little bit more on key.
Huh.
Because I was a big Patsy Cline fan back in the day, but I totally didn't pick it up.
Yeah, I'm not a huge Patsy Cline fan, but I definitely know the song.
So, director, won't belabor it, Greg Nicotero. Although Samantha Morton did say when they interviewed her for talking that she was really excited about working with Greg Nicotero. And I have to say, when they showed him on talking, I was like, I know it's been 10 years, but dang, Greg has aged.
Okay, I was
As have
actually
we
looking at
all.
him. I was actually looking at him and I was like, okay, he looks thinner and tanner. Like, he just, there was something about him that, like, I don't know, did like the cat, all the cast who are vegan, like, get him to go vegan? Like, 'cause I thought he looked really good.
Oh no, he looks really good, but I was like, dang, it's been 10 years, you know?
Well, and they also had him without glasses too, and that like
Oh,
that totally
good
threw me.
point. You usually don't see him without glasses.
Right.
I dig the
Right.
hair. I'm so glad he grew his hair out. I love it.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Greg was our director. Our writer is a first-time writer to the Walking Dead universe. Her name was Nicole Marante Matthews. I hope I'm saying her hyphenated name correctly. She was born in Seattle and she graduated from Washington State University in Pullman.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so kind of a hometown girl for us.
Yeah.
She actually began her career as a TV news reporter.
Wow.
Yeah. And she wrote for Dun 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 Law and Order Criminal Intent. And this was her, as I said, this was her first for the Walking Dead universe. The stuff that I recognized in her other writing credits, she wrote two episodes of Luke Cage. She wrote for NCIS. And then some things that I didn't recognize, Kane, The Nine, Huff.
Nope, I don't
Yeah,
recognize
they
those either.
didn't ring a bell for me, but you know, she's got a good start in the Walking Dead universe. This was a solid episode.
You don't know what where she was a reporter for, do you?
No, they didn't say that on IMDb, and I didn't
Okay.
explore beyond that. I'm
Interesting.
guessing since she graduated from Wazoo that it was probably somewhere in Washington that she was reporting.
Yeah, I'm just thinking like Northwest Cable News or something, or King
Right.
5 or Cairo or
Right.
something.
That's
Yeah.
totally what I was thinking. It was like King Five.
See, I can still rattle them all off. Ugh, been a
So,
news
welcome.
baby since I was a child.
Oh my God, the news. I was watching the debates before I came in.
Nope, I won't, wouldn't do it.
Yeah, don't go there. It's bad for
Nope. Yeah.
the morale. So, anyway, welcome Nicole Marante Matthews. I think you
Yes.
did a creditable job writing this episode.
Great episode.
So, you know, I had thought maybe we were going to talk about Gamma, but then when I saw Gamma's sister, when Alpha had her take off her mask, I was like, where do I know her from?
Do you know her?
No, but she looked so familiar to me. And then I looked through stuff for featured cast and I thought, I have no idea who this actress is.
Well, and of course, we're going to use Juliet Brett, who played Gamma's sister. And if you look it on IMDb, she actually has a name.
Yeah, I
And
didn't catch it in the episode, did you?
no, I didn't. Even on The Talking Dead, the credits referred to her as Gamma's sister. She didn't have a name, but her name was Frances, apparently. But so we're going to do Juliet Brett because, of course, she died this episode.
Right, and I figure we'll have plenty of time to talk about Gamma, so.
Exactly. And there's so much to talk about with Gamma.
Yes.
Right. So you didn't recognize Juliet from anything, huh?
No, I totally thought when I saw her, oh my God, where do I know that actress from? But then when I looked at her credits, I thought, I'm thinking of somebody else. I must be.
Well, she was in an episode of Law and Order Special Victims
she
Unit.
She was.
And CSI.
And that was her first credit, was Law and Order SVU. So.
And CSI New York was her second. Yeah. So that's where she got her start. She, I think, is probably most known for an FX series called Foss and Verdon.
Fosse and Verdon. Okay. So it's about, I want to say Fosse is a famous dancer or famous choreographer. Famous choreographer.
Greatest Broadway dancer of all time is what she's credited as. Gwen Verdon and Bob Fosse. He was an influential choreographer and director.
Okay.
So they had an offspring named Nicole. And
that's who Juliet plays.
Right. The real Nicole Fosse is actually the executive producer of the show. So Juliet Brett actually plays Nicole from ages 12 to 17, which is a really pivotal time in her life. And it just shows her growing up with these super famous parents and the kind of like adult life that she was exposed to and everything. So it actually looks super interesting. I watched the trailer on YouTube. I had never seen anything on it before. So it's a TV miniseries. So there's only three of them. Yeah, it looks like three of them.
So it could actually make the list.
It could make the list this weekend. We have a 3-day weekend. So.
Oh, but we also have to go see Zombieland.
That's true.
Yes.
That's true. I do have to.
Yeah.
And my theater actually just started selling tickets online.
Oh, my God.
I know. Like, we're coming up in the world. We might actually get Zombieland this weekend.
I bet you will. I'd be shocked if you didn't.
I think so. So the other thing that she looks like she was pretty prominent in was a TV series called Redheads Anonymous.
And a show called Red Oaks, which I've heard of but have not watched.
Same thing, yeah. I've heard of it, but I haven't watched. Interesting thing about Redheads Anonymous, she's also credited as a writer and a producer on the show.
Oh, very cool. I saw that she had writer and producer credits, but I didn't look to see what they were.
Yeah, so all of the five episodes, it looks like I think she was in... She was also a writer and producer, and that was in 2015. So I believe she's 26 now.
You
so
got
four
it.
Years
yep.
ago, that would make her 22. So, yeah, she's got some chops. I watched a couple of interviews with her, and I think they're at least a couple of years old, if not older, because she seems very young and unpolished, and I don't mean that in a bad way. She is totally the girl next door.
But she didn't come off... She wasn't very prepossessing in the interviews.
Right. And there's one interview where she's very muted, but the roles that she has chosen are completely not her personality. So I find that super interesting because she comes off as just like your normal girl next door that you knew in high school. And she just has these very serious roles. I was reading about one of her off-Broadway shows that she was in called Napoli Brooklyn. And it's got some pretty serious subject matter. So, the Muscanos, I won't read the whole thing. it's pretty long and it's pretty serious. And then she's got a couple of upcoming credits that have some kind of serious subject matter. The first one is a short called Telephone. It's only 20 minutes long. And the IMDb says, after a message passes through three generations, the youngest travels from Montauk to East New York to identify the body of her dead father, only to find out she has a second chance to say goodbye and to come to terms with his estrangement. So, yeah, and it's only 20 minutes long.
Apparently we're having some distress out in the front room.
The dogs are really excited about it.
About something. They're really excited about Julie Brett.
Exactly. And then she's got a movie in post-production called Listen. And she's not the main character, it looks like, but she's actually credited above the main character in the credits. So she doesn't play Dara, but Dara Nevo, a young and dedicated soldier in the Israeli Defense Force, elite intelligent unit, races against the clock to find an Israeli soldier captured in Gaza before her father's killer is released in a prisoner exchange.
That sounds pretty intense.
Yeah, so it was funny to watch interviews with her and how just light and bubbly she was, and then she goes and plays all these serious roles. So the only social media I found for her was her Instagram, Julie Brett on Instagram. I love her bio. It says overly sentimental. And I love her Instagram because she is a complete animal lover. I think she has at least two dogs, maybe three. She's got three that reoccur, and two that I found names for that I actually can't remember at this point. Oh, Toast. She has a puppy named Toast.
I love it. That's hilarious.
And it's got a little speckled nose, like it's freckled, like she is. She's also a big dancer. She dances ballet.
Very cool.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting. And yeah, she's just a normal 26-year-old, it seems like. And she fell into the lap of The Walking Dead for exactly one episode.
But she had an interesting and compelling character.
She did. And actually, it was more than one episode if you count the episodes last season.
True. Now, I wonder if she was she actually credited for those episodes? I don't think she was.
It doesn't look like she was, no.
And we never actually saw the face of the whisperer that she supposedly was, so.
No, that's a very good point. Yeah. This is her one and only credit on that she's credited on IMDb. So I don't know if they used another actress or if she just hasn't been credited yet. Credited.
They probably did. I mean, they probably used another actor and probably just used her in this role because they were giving her lines and right. showing her face.
Right. And I don't even think Thora Birch was the actress or credited in the episode where quote-unquote Gamma's sister, I guess is what we're calling her, leaves her baby in the field.
Yeah, this is the first episode that Thora Birch was in. She was saying that like one of the first scenes that she shot was killing her sister. So. Right.
So, yeah, that's Juliet Brett. She's got some past stuff we should all check out, and she's got some upcoming stuff that looks pretty good. So keep your eye out.
Yeah, she was interesting. I liked her.
Yeah.
Well, Whisperer's Corner doesn't have a lot tonight, but the first one is addressing the ratings. So new series low, that was according to Deadline.com. But they actually said in their article that they think that a lot of this is because episodes are now available through AMC Premiere. And yep. they noted in their article that AMC Premiere is doing quite well.
That's not shocking.
So
AMC is on top of their game right now as far as shows.
It would be really nice to know what the numbers from AMC Premiere are.
Yeah, there's got to be a way that they track it.
I'm sure they must. And if they were smart, they would put out some pushback about what the Walking Dead ratings are. But
right.
Anyway, I just thought that was interesting that they actually took the time to address the premiere service and mentioned that it was doing well.
I wonder if that was just a kind of a don't worry, advertisers.
Right.
Your message is getting out there, Subway. Eat yeah. fresh.
Let's see. The other kind of big piece of news that I found was that Ryan Hurst actually admitted that he was hospitalized for heat exhaustion filming this season.
Oh, wow.
Which kind of makes sense, you know, being in the mask and the leather coat and all those layers. And he's a big dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it sounds like it was pretty brief and he ended up being fine, but it was, quote, heat exhaustion.
Hmm.
And there were a couple different articles that talked about that. And then there was an article on Insider.com where Norman Reedus actually talked about getting fan mail thanking him for Daryl representing asexuality, which I thought was very interesting.
I do too. I don't know if I consider him asexual.
It sounds like Kirkman at one point talked about him being, his character being really asexual, but it also, you know, Norman Reedus in his cagey, I'm not really going to answer the question kind of way, kind of hinted that maybe that wouldn't so much be the case.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. It's gotta be because one, they haven't given him a love interest, and two, he has such a strong platonic relationship with Carol.
Which, that was one other thing I wanted to point out from the article, which was at Insider.com. They talked to Angela Kang in the article, too, and she confirmed that this season is going to be really heavy with Daryl-Carol interactions.
Hmm. Heavy as in dramatic, or heavy as in there's going to be a lot of them?
Heavy as in there's going to be a lot.
Okay. That's yeah.
And then I did take the time to look at the articles by Paul Tassie and Eric Kane this week. So Paul Tassie's article was basically speculation about how Michonne would leave and how Maggie will return. So he's really thinking that they won't kill off Michonne because they don't want to totally cut off the possibility of her coming back to the universe.
Okay.
So there, he's speculating that either she's going to leave to look for Rick, or there's a possibility that she might be abducted by CRM.
Hmm. So those are the possibility of her just leaving to look for Rick, kind of like Dwight.
Well, and who, I can't remember who I was listening to. Maybe it was Diana and Steve. They were talking about how with Maggie coming back and being able to be there to take care of RG and Judith, it makes a little more sense.
Yeah, that's true.
And so that was the other thing that Paul Tassie talked about, was Maggie's return. And he said that he thinks probably Maggie will get news of the deaths of her friends at the hands of the Whisperers and decide that she's coming back for revenge.
Okay, I don't remember where I saw it or where I heard it, but they were talking about how, oh my gosh, Maggie doesn't even know that all of these people died, blah, blah, blah. But they've been writing letters back and forth to Maggie, so I'm sure that made it into a letter.
You know, you would think, I mean, I can't imagine that they would keep it from her, but what a horrible thing just to get a letter about.
Yeah.
Not that they have any other way to communicate, but
no, and plus it would be a, hey, we ran into this weirdo freak group. You guys better watch out for them too, because they're nomadic.
And they do horrible things.
Yeah.
Like?
And you can't figure out if they're walkers or not.
Right. Until you're too close.
Yep.
And then let's see. Eric Kane actually talked about Beta's backstory. And Tom O'Mara brought this up to me, too, because they made a reference to him with the records in Fear the Walking Dead. So Eric Kane is saying Beta is a singer who was in rehab for drug and alcohol abuse, and that's probably why he was where we ended up finding him or meeting him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, quote, it was a strong character building episode. So he really liked the episode.
Good.
And so that actually reminds me, Tom and I had a pretty long conversation on Facebook the other night. So I told him that I would tell people to please attend his Fear the Walking Dead panel at Walker Stalker Con this coming weekend. He's actually going to be moderating the Fear the Walking Dead panel.
Where is it located?
This is the Atlanta show.
Okay, Atlanta.
The
okay.
Biggie. The Biggie.
I don't think he'll be hurting for people attending a panel at Walker Stalker.
Well, and he also has an awesome idea for a surprise for the audience, and I'm just going to leave it at that.
Oh.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
And you know how creative and funny he is.
Yeah.
So what he said to me about Beta, on The Talking Dead, Ryan basically confirmed the Fear of the Walking Dead rumor, and the song he was humming was Patsy Cline, leading to the point he was a famous country singer, which is why when Alpha looked under the mask, she had a look of recognition.
Yeah. Yep. I believe in the comics, that's why he wears the mask, because he was somebody famous before the apocalypse.
So I looked it up because I misremembered. I knew that he had been a sports ball star. I was thinking he was a football star, but he was actually a player in the NBA.
Okay.
So that was his story in the comics. But
I can see country singer. I could see football player, but I couldn't see Ryan Hurst as a basketball star.
No, I think this is a much better backstory.
Yeah,
and I like the way that they kind of wove it in with the mental hospital and with the song, and I just thought they did a really good job with his backstory.
Yeah.
So that's all I've got for Whisperer's Corner. It was pretty slim tonight.
So, I have something on the intro.
Oh, very good.
Have you been paying attention?
Which, by the way, I did watch it, and what did I write down? I wrote down that I saw the bridge, so thank you for bringing that to my attention. The other thing it looked like to me was it looked like they added the graveyard where Jesus was killed.
Oh, I didn't catch that.
Yeah, I think they did.
So this week they added the burning fuselage of the satellite.
Oh, cool.
They have added the forest fire right before the horses that Rick and Michonne are on rear up. And when at the end you see the windmill and you see like the bug or whatever crawling into the walker's eyes, and then they kind of spin around.
Uh-huh.
One of the walkers in the field has the thing up the back, so it's a mask. It's not a real walker.
It's a whisperer.
Yeah, so the intro keeps changing because I actually went back and watched the first episode of season 10. And some of those things were not there, so they are changing the intro every episode so far.
Okay, so it's totally your job from here on out to monitor that.
I will try and stay on it. I love that they did that in Fear. That was a nice change mm-hmm. that they had done in Fear. And so it's kind of cool that they're doing it in The Walking Dead now, because we watched for it last season.
And I think they just changed it once. Didn't they just change it from the begin? Like the premiere of last season was different from the other ones, or maybe it was just that it was a new way of doing the title card.
I think it was just the new way of doing the title card. Oh, and at the end when you see the credits, The Walking Dead, mm-hmm. You know how you were saying it had the green and everything?
Mm-hmm.
At the bottom, it has red, and I don't know if it was supposed to be blood or fire. So they are definitely changing things up. So watch for those.
Very cool. All right. Good, bad, and ugly.
So I have to tell you that my good and my bad were both very minor, and my ugly is what I want to talk about. So my good, I love how we ended the episode. We ended it exactly where we ended last episode.
Oh my God, that's funny. Our goods are very similar.
Yeah.
They're not exactly the same, but they're very similar.
I loved that. Normally, I hate the wonky time thing, but because we had the satellite to kind of tell us that we were in the same time frame as our other group, and then at the end, we saw Alpha and Carol across the canyon. So I just loved that they have tied it all in together, caught us all up. They did it in two episodes, bing, bang, boom, it's done. Let's move on to the Whisperer's War.
Okay, it's so funny how our brains work so similarly sometimes. What I wrote down was I liked the satellite as the through line, and yeah. I like the way that they linked this episode to the premiere and brought us up to the same point on the timeline.
Oh, we do not plan this.
The other thing I said in my good was that I really appreciated that it wasn't all backstory. I liked the way that they kind of flipped us back and forth between 7 years ago and now.
Yeah.
They did it really artfully, and I've got some stuff in Rotting Potpourri about something that I observed with that.
Okay, good.
So then what was your bad? You said it was relatively minor.
So my bad wasn't even about anything about the show. you know how we complain about it's too dark, it's too quiet.
Mm-hmm.
I know that they're whisperers.
But it's hard to tell what they say sometimes.
Oh, so I was watching Talking Dead and they do the little trivia thing and they were like the first two questions, if you look at how many people got it right, like none of us could hear anything. It was so hard to make out what they were saying sometimes that I actually just gave up. I mean,
and because of the masks, you can't tell because you don't really get facial features or you can't really read anything.
Well, and Alpha is so, even when before she was wearing the mask and everything, she was so very soft spoken, and but she was also very clipped in her words. She's not very wordy. She's very monosyllabic.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it was just really hard to get what they were trying to communicate in a scene. So, and you can't turn it up because of course the next scene is, you know, a satellite
is going to blast out your eardrums.
Yeah. So that really was my biggest bad is, and maybe it's because now I have to like pay attention and get off my phone.
Because it's actually worth watching.
Right.
But
it's just, yeah, too quiet.
Okay, so this was my glaring contradiction in this episode. So they spend all of this time talking about how they're animals and they're the pack and they're the dead and they're empty, but they rely so much on rituals.
Mm-hmm.
Which I thought was just a major contradiction. You know, the whole anointing of Gamma and then the way that they recited that creed with each other at the end.
Yeah.
And I gotta tell you, when they touched palms, I was like, wow, it's riffraff and magenta. So it was totally like that moment when they're getting ready to do the time warp in Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Exactly. I was like, okay, so explain who Riff Raff and Magenta yes. are for those who are not Rocky Horror fans.
Or for those who are not as old as we are.
Oh, come on. They redid Rocky Horror a couple years ago.
Criminal. I'm sure it was great. I remember thinking the cast was really interesting, but, you know, come on. Tim Curry?
I can't beat
that.
Nope. There is no beating Tim Curry.
Yep.
In fishnets.
But anyway, so that was my bad, is that I just felt like, you know, you can't have it both ways. You can't be empty and the dead, but then have like this elaborate set of rituals.
But if you're a cult leader, you can tell people anything and they will believe you.
That's
true.
They
will follow you.
That's true. And she is very good.
Oh, she is. We'll talk about that later too.
All right, and, you want to... Oh, go ahead.
In fact, we'll talk about it right now.
Because that's your ugly.
My ugly is Alpha. I actually wrote down, Alpha is full of bleep. Only I didn't write bleep. So, her whole, we're strongest when we spill our own blood, or our kin's blood, or whatever she said. She had told Gamma's sister that when she killed her daughter, she didn't shed a tear, and you know she's totally full of it.
Did she actually say in last season, did she actually go back and tell the Whisperers that she had killed Lydia? Because I missed that, if she did. Or is that something that was just revealed in this episode?
I don't remember if she did or not. I want to say no, just because I don't remember. But it's quite possible that she made mention to it to at least Beta.
I just didn't remember that as a plot point from last season.
Yeah, I don't remember that either. I just remember her in the crazy blonde wig and thinking she was like one of the Manson chicks.
But she's very good at selling her reality.
Oh, she is. Because she does the quintessential cult leader thing. She strips people's personas away from them. She took away their names. She takes away their faces. You know, she strips people down and then she builds them to whatever she wants them to be. And she's just a perfect cult leader. And she's a total hypocrite too, which is the perfect cult leader. You know,
right.
She is not living her own lie. She is not drinking the Kool-Aid. Like, She is feeding it to everybody else, but she has so many feelings that she can't handle it. And I feel like Beta, the reason why they flipped back and forth in time is we saw her take hold of him, and he is so invested in what she's about that he has to keep her secrets. He has to, you know, keep everyone else from finding out the truth, and he has to, you know, keep her going and all this other stuff, because his own identity relies on hers and he can't lose that.
And I actually believe him when he says that he feels nothing.
Oh, I do too, because, like, even before, like, I think Thora Birch pointed it out on Talking Dead, where she's like, that, you know, one of the first things he said is, like, my favorite song is The Sound of the Dead, and I hope it never ends.
Which I wrote down in my notes, all-time creepiest line from Walking Dead.
Right?
Yes.
Like, it's that, and, like, it puts the lotion on the skin or it gets the hose again. Like, those are just the creepiest things. Ugh. All right. So that was my ugliest. Alpha is a total cult leader hypocrite, and she's full of it.
So my ugly is probably what everyone else's ugly was, which was the cool and awful origin of Beta's mask.
And I love that it was changed.
I wrote that down. Yes. I love that they were actually going to have Alpha do it in the script, and then Ryan Hurst and Samantha Morton were like, no, it would be so much more impactful if Beta does it.
Yeah, definitely. Oh, and I really kind of want to know more about his friend now. Mm-hmm. Like, why couldn't he leave this person? You know, we've seen it before where people can't kill other people even after they've turned, but he wouldn't even leave the body, and he chose to not leave the body entirely.
Well, and remember how they told us last season that, like, all of the elements of his costume were drawn from other characters?
Mm-hmm.
The smiley face shirt was his friend's.
And I did not catch that until Talking Dead.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's so crazy.
Yeah.
Oh, that was almost my rating too, but then I was like, oh, bunnies.
So I think we're deep into writing potpourri now.
I think so. I had one other thing that could have been my bad, but it was so super minor that most people probably did not pick up on it. So when Alpha goes and rattles against the gate, that gate was raised automatically. Like, I don't know how that gate still had power, but nobody was, like, pulling on a chain to raise that gate.
I am not flashing on that scene at all.
It's when they were walking around gathering up all of the walkers and from all the buildings. There was a metal gate, and it was one of those, like, in a mall where it's just rolls up into itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it rolled up automatically, like somebody had pushed a button, because it went up quickly and smoothly. And I was like, no.
I totally missed that.
I'm thinking, okay, the effects guys should know if they have a button to push to, like, make something do something automatically, that they shouldn't do it. It should be
because
manually
it's not
done
work.
Somehow.
Yeah.
Right. It's someone's going to pick up on that wouldn't really happen like that. So I've now become the person that I hate that nitpicks all of this stuff. Like, one of those, like, total gun people who's like, You wouldn't hold that gun that way.
Well, that's why we watch as closely as we watch, you know?
Exactly. At least I don't, like, yell it out when it happens. I write it down furiously.
Well, so this is a little thing, but in the credits when I recorded it, Melissa McBride is now listed as Melissa Suzanne McBride.
Really?
Yeah, which I thought was kind of interesting.
Huh.
I was kind of wondering where that came from.
Yeah. She's not that way on IMDb.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it was just a weird thing in Dish Network. Who knows?
Or maybe it's a different Melissa McBride. No, I doubt it.
All right. So the kill of the survivor, the unnamed survivor at the very beginning.
Oh, my God. That was graphic.
I loved them biting her nose off. That was so good.
Okay. Like Chris Hardwick said, we can't say the F word on TV, but we can see. Well, he said get somebody getting their face cut off. Like, but that, like, I was like, that was my first thought was I was like, we can't show a female nipple on TV, but we can show that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my god, that of course we were having spaghetti too. That didn't help.
That's awesome.
Right? It's always a red sauce. We're always eating red sauce on Sunday night. Oh, yeah.
You should know better by now.
I know. It's terrible. It's always like chili or lasagna or something. So but
did you catch the name of the mental health clinic? I know that it was one of the questions on the quiz, but I didn't catch it.
I didn't.
And I didn't see where it was posted, but I'm sure it was because it was part of the quiz.
Huh. No, I didn't catch it.
It was something like Second Chances or Second Lives. I mean, it was kind of ironic.
Oh, yeah. That would be ironic.
I'm logging into Facebook so I can see biters.
I love when Alpha said, we're all monsters now.
Right. And then when Lydia later in the episode was like, we're all monsters now. We're all monsters now.
Well, and it was so sad. The scene where Lydia didn't want her bunny anymore. And she's like, I want to be more like you, mama. I want to be strong. And Alpha's like, I've always wanted you to say that. And it was so sad the way she was like, you know, you'll have to be strong or I'll leave you. Oh.
And when she was talking to Beta and saying, you know, she was always dead to me. She was always different from me.
Well, and the first thing she told Beta is, you must also kill my daughter because I will not leave this earth without her. So she has this weird relationship of, if you're not just like me, I'm going to abandon you. But she can't abandon Lydia completely because she's such a narcissist that it's a piece of her that she's abandoning and she can't. So it's just, yeah, it's all juxtapositioned.
It was pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, I just, the psychology of it all is so fascinating.
Well, so since we're talking psychology, I thought that the added element of it being a mental hospital and then them finding Beta the way that they did, just kind of standing there still in the hallway masked, just added to the creep factor times 10.
Right? I mean, you have zombies chasing you and all of a sudden, like, Creepster is, like, down the hall and he won't speak. Oh, it's straight out of a horror movie.
And which, I felt like it was kind of Greg Nicotero and his horror chops kind of really creating that vibe.
Mm-hmm.
There's one scene where Lydia is walking up the stairs. And it's just so creepy. The stairwell is so creepy and the way that it's lit and the way that it was shot. I thought, good on you, Nicotero.
Well, and did you notice all of the writing on the walls?
Yes.
Yeah.
Especially the one that was like, the end of the world, the end of the world, the end of the world.
Yeah. It, like, all work and no play makes Johnny a dull boy.
Oh, did it say that?
No, it didn't. Yeah. But it was straight out of a horror film, you know?
No, I totally feel like that was Greg Nicotero creating that vibe. It was really well done.
Well, and I also love what the other perspective. I love what Ryan Hurst had to say about how he's been, you know, alone in this mental hospital and he lost his friend and, you know, he's gone through whatever he's gone through. And then these two females show up and he's almost not sure that they are real, you know? I love that perspective from him, that he, you know, he that deep into the character, he would think that, you know, he's so deep in his own psychosis that, you know, he's seeing things.
He was definitely unwell. Definitely, yeah. Unwell.
Oh, and Ryan Hurst plays it so well.
You know, he really was great this episode. I mean, I've enjoyed him, but he was great this episode.
Yeah, yeah. And I loved him in Sons, so... and he and Thora Birch were so funny on Talking Dead. Mm-hmm. I love the story where, like, her first day on set, and she's like, I don't know how to act. They're just telling me to go over there and you know, be a walker. And Ryan Hurst is like, oh, yeah, you just go do your thing. Go do it, you know? They were funny. And then the story he told about Sarah. Do you remember?
About Samantha, you mean?
Or Samantha, yes.
Being vegan.
Yep.
Yeah.
That was so funny. And yes, I would kill him if he told that story about me on The Talking Dead. I'm sure she took it in great stride. I love the interviews with her because she's so eloquent and soft-spoken. I mean, it's a different soft-spoken than Alpha.
She's interesting. She's very poised.
Yes. Yes. And so just seeing her dressed as Alpha and speaking with this posh British accent and very, you know, eloquently, it's so weird to see.
I was totally going to say something I know what I was going to say. So the very first scene where they see each other, the way that she stands up to Beta is so cool. She really comes off as really badass because he's just giant and scary, and she totally puts him in his place.
You know, I was actually thinking, like, I actually admire their bravery. And she said it at some point in the show where she's like, you're either brave enough to walk among the dead or you're not. And watching them when they're walking in the herds and they have pretty much no fear, or if they do, they're obviously not, you know, letting on that. I mean, when they were going through the hallway, when the two of them were going through the hallway and they were killing all of those walkers, that would have terrified any of the other, our group members, you know, they would have probably run the other direction rather than go head on into this small herd and kill them. And here these two are, you know, and they don't even communicate. They just go do it. And now, you know, they're walking around with, you know, large hordes of walkers that at any moment, if you cry out or lose your mask or, you know, anything, you know, this entire, you're surrounded and they just do this. And so I kind of admire the bravery, you know, and she had that from the beginning. She was doing it before she had ran into Beta.
Speaking of losing your mask, when Frances, Gamma's sister, dies,
mm-hmm.
her mask is off. Which I thought was really symbolic of her, like, not being a whisperer and not being part of that group.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought it was interesting that they're basically not allowed to take their masks off, even in camp, when they're supposedly kind of safe. Because we learned, I think it was last season, where they take turns keeping the hordes. Like, it's almost like herding.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're back at camp, you would expect to be able to take that stinky hot mask off. But the only one who's allowed to do it is Alpha. The only time they had their masks off is when they slept.
Which, again, makes sense. It's a control thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's stripping people of their identities.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Let's see. I wrote down, there was another line. I think Alpha said this. Those of us strong enough to kill... No, those of us strong enough to still be alive out here know each other on a primal level.
Mm-hmm.
She said that to Beta, and I was like, oh, the writing in this episode is really good. So I just wanted to say that because our writer was a new writer.
That's when he asked her if she had a name. And I love it when he asked her if she had a name and she didn't give it to him. But then she didn't ask him if he had a name. She designated him a name. Again, it's all about the control.
It's she's creating the reality.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I thought that that it was good to see a little bit of dissent and dissatisfaction in the Whisperers.
Oh yeah.
When the woman came up to Francis and was like, "I think about that place too. It was so safe.
They had livestock. Mm-hmm. We could be safe there." Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely. I liked the kind of mirroring that they did with the scene of Beta freaking out
That was one of the things that I was going to talk about when I said, yeah, we'll talk about that a little bit more, is that last scene where they kind of interwove now and then,
mm-hmm.
kind of simultaneously, rather than saying flashing to now and then giving us a whole bunch of stuff in the now and then flashing to the time 7 years ago, they kind of interwove it more skillfully. And mm-hmm. it was really about Alpha and Beta both having things that they needed to let go of.
Mm-hmm.
For Beta, it was his friend. For Alpha, it was Lydia.
But, you know, and again, she's such a hypocrite because she's so big on we don't feel anything, you know? And here she was throwing this huge tantrum.
But again, it's control.
Yeah.
I mean, you're right about the hypocrisy of a cult leader. They get to do and say and feel all of the things that they don't allow their followers to feel.
Yeah.
go ahead.
I'm actually just rolling through the episode right now, and it's the part where they are disemboweling a walker together for the first time.
Oh, I love that line. And he's like, "Well, you're different."
That was great.
The line was funny. The way that he delivered the line was really funny. That was a good line. I really thought that the reveal of Francis being the walker who had the baby last season was a really mm-hmm. good reveal. That was an interesting little tidbit.
Well, and I love the way that it played so much into the rebellion, because all of us last season were like, how could anybody let their baby die? Like, just set it down in a field and, you know, let walkers rip it apart.
But fortunately, that didn't happen, remember? He actually was adopted by Hilltop.
Right. Connie saved him.
Connie saved him, and then Tammy and Earl adopted mm-hmm. him, or they were going to. I don't know what happened to him after Tammy was killed, but...
Right. Yeah, because Earl wasn't doing too good before Tammy died, so right. Lord knows how he's doing now.
He seemed like he was doing pretty good when we caught up with him last episode.
Oh, I didn't catch it.
Yeah. I mean, it was just a little, like, vignette. He was helping put out the fire, but he seemed like he was doing fine.
Oh, okay. Huh. Yeah, I like how it played into, like, she was almost having this, like, this psychosis. I mean, she would stop and, you know, stare up at the sun and hear the baby cry. And, you know, I just, it answered a lot of stuff where we would, like, you know, a lot of us are, who probably have never had experience with a cult are like, how could you ever do that? And then, and of course, she was able to do it, but she wasn't able to live with herself.
Well, and that whole scene where Alpha was going to punish her and then ended up kind of comforting her and letting her cry
mm-hmm.
was really creepy. And when I looked at the actress and looked at the actress as Frances, they did a great job casting her next to Thora Birch. They looked like sisters, but mm-hmm. boy, did she look like Alpha in that moment.
Hmm. I thought that it was sort of channeling Lydia, like,
Well, and so Beta says, you know, you're trying to replace Lydia,
right?
But more with Gamma. But no, if you go back and watch that scene, it's kind of eerie how much she looks like Alpha.
Huh. I'll have to do that. Because I was distracted because her hair looked, it reminded me of the one redheaded kid from Children of the Corn.
Oh, that's it was, funny.
It was so 80s feathered.
And I thought she looked like a young Thora Birch.
Oh, huh. That's funny. Yeah, she kind of did look like Thora Birch in Hocus Pocus.
Mm-hmm.
That's funny.
I don't know that I've got a whole lot more. I mean, obviously they're setting us up for the confrontation. Oh, I do have a little bit about that. So, you know, Nick was watching the last episode with me, and at the end he said, Carol could have totally shot Alpha if she wanted to. Because there was enough time before they locked eyes where Carol laid a bead on her that she totally could have shot her.
Definitely. And that's, I mean, I was saying we kind of had two different thoughts on the same coin, you know, two different sides of the coin. Is I was like, she had enough time to duck and hide so that Alpha didn't see her. And Nick was like, she had totally enough time to shoot Alpha before she saw her.
She had totally enough time to take Alpha out, but then we wouldn't have the season, so.
Right. Right.
I don't think I have anything else. It was a really good episode. I really enjoyed it. Not quite as much as last episode, but I still feel like we're back.
Yeah, absolutely. It is a breath of fresh air.
It really is.
Even if it does smell like a herd of walkers.
So we got some cool shares from Dianne LaSorsa. She was in Georgia when they were filming this episode, so she's actually got some stills from the filming of this episode.
Oh, very cool.
She posted a really amazing picture of the admitting door, like with blood running down the steps.
Okay, so I was wondering about that. When Alpha first and Lydia first ran up to those steps, I was like, huh, that's really disconcerting. Either someone bloody was dragged in or dragged out.
Well, it is the zombie apocalypse.
Yeah. Usually there's not that much blood, though. That was one of the things that drove me nuts about last episode, was when Carol slit the throat of the walker and put the fire out. I'm like, there would not be that much liquid blood.
I don't know. You know, I mean, there was an awful lot of blood when they killed that survivor in front of Alpha and Lydia.
Because it was fresh, right?
But yeah, I mean, that blood was dried blood, the blood going down the stairs. So it could have been from a big kill like that.
Okay.
I guess I'm not following.
Yeah, I would imagine in walkers that all of the blood would have pooled or coagulated, or, you know, it happens pretty quickly. So to slit a walker's throat and have it spray blood, or to have the blood, that much blood drain out of a walker as you're dragging it up and down, I would imagine the blood, that much blood would come from somebody whose heart's still beating.
Again, you know, it could have been someone like that survivor who was killed. I guess I'm just not following why it's... Yeah.
Sometimes we aren't on the same page.
We're not on the same... We're not on the same page.
No.
Anyway, the pictures that Dianne shared were really cool. And then we got some written feedback from her. She said, oh my God, loved episode 2. Opening scene was great. This felt like old Walking Dead. Backstory was good and needed and done well. Great walker action. Walkers eating girl. Walker kills. Cutting up walkers. Felt like classic Walking Dead. Loved the cult feel from the Whisperers. Gamma intro was good. It started and before I knew it was over and I wanted more. Need to hum me some Patsy Cline. And then Tom O'Mara shared the teaser from the Supervan show that he was on, so people should check that out. He put that on our page on October 12th, so there's a little link talking about him and his love of all things Walking Dead.
That's so awesome.
Yeah. I'm not sure that we had anything else.
No.
Just checking through. You posted a hilarious picture from Oktoberfest. Those are pretty impressive beer steins.
That's why I go. I go to get the giant steins.
Oh, Pedro Pelez did say that he had some recommendations for Chicago if we end up going for FanFest, and that's where he's from.
That is so cool. Like, everyone cool is from Chicago, apparently, or
Or
lives in Chicago, except
somewhere east of
Utah.
there.
Yeah.
Well, other than that, you got anything else?
I don't. We are two episodes in, and I am so happy we're here, and we have so many episodes left. It's great. I'm excited.
If the first two episodes are any sign as to how the season's gonna go, it's gonna be a pretty awesome season.
Definitely. So we actually podcast on time this week. So everyone have a good week.
All right.
Happy Alaska Day.
It's not Alaska today, is it?
No, it will be on Friday. No. But until then, just remember, take
Take
it
it
one
one
dead
dead
day
day
at a
at a
time.
time.
Have a good week, everybody.
Have a good week.
Bye.
Bye. Ugh.